Thank you for listening to the CPA Trendlines podcast, a production of CPAtrendlines.com, now available on iTunes. CPA Trendlines presents a production of the Center for Accounting Transformation. In a new age of watchmen, a team of individuals pooling their talents and abilities come together to bring analysis, reaction, and comedy to the fold. This is their chronicle. This is Accounting Arc.
All right, welcome everyone. I am very excited today to welcome Bailey to the ARC podcast. And part of the reason I'm excited is that she is doing some amazing work down under, as it might be. But rather, let me have you introduce it. Bailey, why don't you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit of what you do?
Hi, thanks so much, Donny. So hello, my name is Bailey Lenart, and I do many things, but I actually have two startups, one a service-based business called World Changing Business that supports accountants to make the shift into non-financial accounting and measuring different forms of value like emissions or biodiversity loss and the like. They also have a software startup called Collective Flow. And the goal of that is really to look at how can we change the status quo of work, because to be honest, work kind of sucks, and I think it can be a place that we have a lot of fun, joy, and can bring our gifts to save the world, whatever that may be. But I am living in Whangaparawa, New Zealand. I've been in New Zealand for 16 years now, but I'm originally from South Florida, and I attended Florida Atlantic University. I won't tell you the year. And did all of my study in accounting to be a CPA before deciding to move to New Zealand.
And if I remember correctly, you are a CA instead now? Am I remembering that?
Yes. Right? Yep. So I am a chartered accountant in New Zealand. So it's very similar to the CPA process in America. So I was able to do a little bit of postgraduate study. So it was called Honors in New Zealand rather than Masters. And similarly, you get your lived experience working in an accounting firm for 4 years. And through that, you're doing some study throughout it. And that all culminated in a 6-hour written exam to become a chartered accountant. But funnily enough, I left the accounting industry, or being an accountant, right as soon as I got my designation.
Well, that's the whole point of this this podcast, or not the podcast, but this set of episodes. Because we always talk about these traditional accountants, and in this one, I'm interviewing non-traditional accountants. So not just that you're a CA, because that's an accountant, but tell us a little more about what you do. Why is what you do now non-traditional from an accounting standpoint?
Well, when I was at university, I was actually in the Accounting Scholars Program at FAU, the inaugural year of it. So I wasn't just an accounting student. I was an exceptionally nerdy accounting student in Beta Alpha Psi, but I was riding my longboard skateboard to class, and I was always, while I was doing, I was studying, I was had camaraderie with my friends or the people I was studying with. I didn't fit the box, but I didn't know that at the same time. I saw accounting and the work I was doing as easy. It was something that surprised me how many people were failing the initial accounting courses. All business majors needed to do the accounting 101 course, and I was able to do it very easily. So for me, it was just like, oh, this is a really easy path for me to follow. But what I found was when I was going into practice, so my first role was at a public accounting firm that was mid-sized. There's about 35 of us in the practice, and we were mostly doing compliance for trust companies and high wealth individuals. And what I found when I was there is I'd pick up a bit of work. So I would be doing the annual financial statements and tax returns for, say, a family and their trust and a company and the like. And I'd be following last year's work papers and I'd be like, well, why do we do it this way? I think there's a better way to do it. But when I talk to my boss, they go, well, you just need to follow last year's work papers. So there was a difference in that. I'd see these opportunities to make positive change and make things easier, but the organization I was in was firmly rooted in just follow what was done before. So that's when I started to realize maybe I was at odds and non-traditional. And what I was really lucky with was when I was about 3 years in to working in this accounting practice, the firm I was at decided to move to this emerging new online accounting software for accountants and small businesses called Xero that was built about less than a mile away from the accounting firm that I was at. And because this was something, there were no work papers last year to follow with how do you move this accounting practice of 2,000 clients who are preparing things in this one way to using this whole new software that's going to change, probably 50% of the processes. I thrived in that situation of figuring out, ooh, what is it we want to achieve? What is our current process? How do I navigate this? How do I support all the other staff? So in accounting practices, you're selling time. And so you're filling out these time sheets, in my case, 6-minute units. And you're always looking at, like, well, how much of my time is billable? So this can be billed to the client or things that aren't billable. And despite me not having as good of a billing rate, you could say, as the staff around me, I ended up getting one of the highest raises when at the end of that year because they could see the value that I had provided that. The other team had higher charge out rates because of the work that I was doing to support them. So, despite bucking the norm of how value was measured within that firm, I was able to still be myself and add value and it be recognized. But what it really helped me do, and I think this is what likely, well, traditional and non-traditional accountants are doing, is just follow what sparks your joy. What do you get lost in? And what do you enjoy? Because that's the thing that you'll be able to do more than anything. That's the thing that's not going to drain you. And luckily, I've been able to make a career of doing that. And funnily enough, it was actually that experience that led me to leaving practice and joining Xero to help other accounting practices. And that was a rocket ship for me. I ended up with a really varied career. I left accounting behind me, went into sales enablement, which was me helping accounting practices across New Zealand to make that same shift that the accounting practice I worked for made. But then, because I was able to explain to people the value of the software and using it together, I ended up establishing their product marketing, which is basically, how do we explain the value of the software to our customers? And what's the best way of supporting them to understand how our software can help them? And so I was in charge of developing the messaging, looking at the websites, working with product teams. So product teams are the people who are building the software, and they have product managers who are the ones who are setting the software strategy. So in software, the most valuable thing that you have is your developer's time. And how do you make sure they're focusing on the most valuable thing at any time? And so when I was working with these product managers to understand the value of what they were building, I started to realize that's who I want to be. That's the work that I want to do. And so I was able to move into product ownership, which was product management, but me looking after a single software development team and leading them and helping them understand what the outcome we're trying to reach is, what the customer's problems were, and then looking in an agile way, which is just a way of saying iteratively delivering that with a cross-functional team over time. And what I really loved about that was if you think about accounting is quite workflow and linear. Like, you know what the steps are, and that's where, you know, right now there's this incredible pause, because as we move into needing to measure things that aren't financial, we don't know what those steps are. But also, when we're in accounting practice, often our peers are people who are doing the same role as us, but maybe not working with us. So it's quite siloed. You know, I've got my work, I know what I need to do. When I'm done, I give it to review, and then I get feedback, and I go back to review, and then I go to partner, to the customer, or to the client, and that's that. But when you're working in software, what you're working with is cross-functional teams. So I'm not the expert. I'm not here to review their work and say, like, oh, your code was bad, or that design, you fix it here. What was amazing was I couldn't do what they did, but they couldn't deliver value. They couldn't develop great software unless I was there to help them understand what to build. And I just saw this value of what collaboration really can be. You know, I don't like the word synergy, because it's just a weird, I don't know, it just seems very like business. Bleh. But what synergy is the sum is greater than the parts, right? The sum of the whole is greater than the parts. And when you have cross-functional teams, you've got that diversity of thought, that's when you get that going. And so from that experience, I then became a mother, which was amazing. My joke from software was that was my best release of 2018, my favorite, or 2017. And when I came back to work, I ended up leading multiple product owners. And so I moved up into this more strategic role. I was like, oh my gosh, I'm in that product manager role. I'm here. You know, I was standing on top of that, you know, mountain, not realizing it was a foothill, and suddenly there was an avalanche coming down. And I had a really interesting experience that led me to really wanting to understand how can I support people and businesses to create the conditions at work where people thrive while also making a net positive impact on the world. And it was that critical experience that's led me to where I'm at now, with looking at how I can support accountants to make that shift into the unknown, leveraging my own experience of learning product management, because that's your skill set, is figuring out how do I reduce the risk of being wrong? How do I figure this out? But also my love of how do I create the conditions within teams? Like, what needs to be true so everybody can bring their most, like, their skills to the table to create, you know, value together that's just way bigger than what they could do separately.
I love that last part that you gave there. And that's what I view my role as, the leader, right? That's our role, is it's not necessarily to do the work anymore, but it's to look at, as you described, this whole structure of team and people and multiple teams, and go, how can we create, I'm going to use the word you don't like, synergy with that. So it's not just 1 + 1 = 2 or 2 + 2 = 4, it's really 1 + 1 = 3 and 2 + 2 = maybe 10, because we're really ramping up and leveraging each other and building this additional energy off of each other to really make something amazing happen.
Exactly. And for me, it was like, I experienced that at the team level. I experienced that, but that wasn't in congruence with the rest of the organization. So my interest now is how do you enable that at scale in an organization? How do you support all of those teams to have that autonomy to create and have clarity of what they're doing and the ability to determine how to do it, but ensure that it weaves together in a cohesive thing with all the other teams that are doing that? Because that's the challenge. Business is how we organize as humans for impact. So if we are going to be working to reduce emissions, to remain tenants in this world, in a warming world, we need to disrupt how we're organizing, because right now the world is rapidly changing, and how do we navigate that is the question I'm really interested in. And I see accountants playing a huge part in that, because the way that we measure success needs to change. And the people who are measuring that value and are stewards for that at the boardroom, with the CFO, through to how budgets are done, that's accounting.
I love that you brought it back to accounting in the end. I want to recap and, tell me if I get any of this wrong. I'm going to recap what you said, but I'm going to keep that accounting context in there. So you started off as what we would say is a traditional accountant from the, but even within that, you, and I feel like that's we're kindred spirits because I was doing the same thing at the firm that I was at. You were looking for, hey, how can we do this better? How do we improve this? Which is really more that consulting mindset. So you're bringing that consulting mindset in while you're with the firm, seeing delivering additional value. And then you really switched and went into software development. And even though when you were telling us the story, you said, oh, well, I'm not accounting anymore. Really, you were because you're at an accounting vendor, accounting software vendor. Because for people that don't know, Xero is basically Intuit's biggest competitor, at least here in the States. And in other parts of the world, like New Zealand, Xero is the software of choice. So you went and moved into that, which is really more of a marketing business development role. And then you moved into product, which typically people think of that as an IT role. But in product, what you were doing was still leveraging your understanding of accounting to drive, hey, here's how you improve this accounting software that we're building to give better value to the users of the accounting software. And then you moved up again after delivering your wonderful child to say, hey, now let me look at how these teams all operate, which in our accounting language, we would say you're moving up into more of the governance where now you can start to create structure, you can create policies, all of these things that we look at as kind of top-down driven things. And all that time adding more value, not focused on this transaction processing and ticking and tying, leveraging your accounting knowledge all the way throughout to standardize and create this additional energy from all of these efforts.
No, that's a really great summary. And I think, as much as I always like to, oh, I'm not the man. I think when I, because I actually ended up moving into a completely non-accounting related role. I'd been leveraging my subject matter expertise of accounting to move into these spaces I didn't have experience. But then I got so much experience that I actually moved into a role where I was leading platform teams. So software teams that build software for other software teams, so developers that built software for accountants, so design systems, identity types, it was fraud security software, things I had no idea about. And I was like, oh, I'm not an accountant anymore, it doesn't matter. But it's how I see the world. You can't take it away from you. And that view of understanding, like, the stocks and flows of things, like the impact, like, well, if we're going to do something here, where is it coming from? Seeing the world in that way has you can't take that away from me. And understanding, I would say, yes, my understanding of accounting, but it was also accountants, like I love accountants. Like I want to work with accountants. Like they're my people. Like I feel so at home. There's no imposter syndrome when I'm working with accountants. It's where I feel the most comfortable.
I
So, yeah.
totally with that. I mean, that's why I love meeting you too. And I know when we first thought we like really hit it off because there's just that different vibe and we're speaking the same language, but the foundation comes back to all accounting, really. That's the thing. We always tell that to all the students. It's like accounting is a foundation that can take you all kinds of places. And you're a great example of how it's taking you all over from traditional accounting into marketing, into product development, into platform, IT platform development. And now, tell us a little bit more about what you're really doing now, especially in your work in ESG and some of the carbon things.
Yeah, this is really funny. So in July 2022, I decided to go out on my own and create a business. I read the phrase world-changing business in a quote in a book, and I was like, that's hilarious. I checked the company's register in New Zealand, checked domains. I'm like, here I am, world-changing dot business. Didn't have any idea what it would be. But the thing that actually made me like interested in how can we can use business as a force for good. How do we use business to heal the world? Was a book called Six Capitals by Jane Gleason White. And the author came to talk at Xero in 2016. And she talked about how, with every change in the world, like step change, be it like agriculture, huge technology shift, double entry bookkeeping, manufacturing, creating vases. That's when manufacturing, like cost accounting came. With every leap in human evolution, because we don't evolve in a linear way. It's these huge step changes. There has been a change in accounting, and where we now know that our impact on the natural world, there is this call to tune, like to change how we're measuring things. And I didn't take that point of me like just hanging on her every word and just feeling completely energized by this talk as that meant anything. I just forgot about it. And even when I mentioned it, my first LinkedIn post, I said, this book changed my life. It wasn't until over a year later that I realized that maybe I should be working in the non-financial accounting space.
What does that mean? Tell me about that. What does that mean, non-financial accounting? Isn't accounting all about dollars?
Well, I guess it's kind of, I really hate it because it's like non-financial accounting is like the term non-binary. You're pointing at the thing it's not. So I think another way of it is holistic accounting. So by us only measuring dollars, we're optimizing for a single element within the wider world. So if I'm doing accounting and I'm optimizing for profit, I might not care that we're emitting heaps into the natural environment, that we're polluting, that we're not paying a living wage, and suddenly the slums within our neighborhoods are growing because but that profit number is big. So what we're talking about with non-financial accounting is actually widening those measures. So what are other things? So if you think about a good way of thinking about this from your studies is likely the balanced scorecard. If you've done that in management accounting, like what are all those other measures? And so carbon accounting, which you might have heard, and you go, what is that? It's perfect for accountants. Let me just tell you that it's perfect. So if we want to remain in a world with a climate that suits us and it doesn't change life, we need to reduce our emissions as a collective fast, very, very fast. And what carbon accounting is getting accurate measures around for this organization, what is their emissions profile? So what are the greenhouse gases that we have emitted into the world that are related to our business's trading? And so what that is for accountants is going through and being able to take activity data, so things like how much petrol or gas, I can't believe I said petrol, gas. How much gas have you bought? What are the fridges that you have and what are the refrigerants and are there any leaks? And what you're doing is it's not just carbon accounting. So I first thought I was like, carbon accounting, why is carbon the only bad GHG emission? Carbon is the currency. So think about if you're looking at financial statements and they're all in US dollars, but you have a New Zealand dollar account, bank account. That is now going to show in the US dollar equivalent. That's what carbon accounting is. So what you're doing is you're doing these calculations to understand from a carbon emissions, like equivalent, a carbon equivalent, what are the emissions related to this? And then you can have really interesting things like what are our emissions per dollar of revenue? What are our emissions per office? What are our emissions per product? But the thing is that over 70 to 80, maybe even 90% of emissions are related to not the things that you're doing as a company, but what you've bought and the emissions related to what you bought. And that's where accountants can come in, because that's what we call the scope 3 problem. That is the value chain. So instead of looking at just this entity and we're saying, well, this is the only thing we have to care about, it's going, well, what are the emissions related to all the people, all the things you bought from, and what are the emissions related to, say, even the end of life of your products? Because that's something. Think about all the Coke bottles. What are all the emissions related to the trash? What's the cost to America to do recycling when most of it's Coke bottles? Why is the government or the waste management wearing that cost? what this is doing with carbon accounting is supporting people to actually measure the true costs. But there's a lot of challenges there. So right now, I'm contracting with an organization called Someday, which is a carbon accounting ledger. And what they're aiming to do is to support accountants to change the world, to move into this non-financial accounting of carbon accounting, and to enable accounting practices to expand their service offerings. So when they're doing the work to kind of go, say you're working with a business and every quarter you go through and you bring in their reports and you show them, hey, this was your performance over the quarter, not just reflecting on their financial performance, but actually going, and this has been your emission profile for this quarter. This is how it compares to the quarter before. And the reason why this is so important is because we don't have that transparency. And where accountants come in is around the rigor, the data collection, the comparability, because the standards related to carbon accounting are accounting standards. They're from IFRS. They are, you know, they're accounting standards, and the best people to do this work are accountants. But the thing is, it's the same problem that we faced when I at my accounting firm, where, hey, there's no last year work papers to follow. So that's where I'm now supporting Someday to actually help their accounting practices figure out how to expand into this space, with the added challenge of helping them build the confidence to move into a space where there are no work papers to follow. There is no right way. This is an emerging field that's changing, but we need to make those changes now, because there's no way you can get to net zero if you don't know where you are today. You don't know your true emissions profile. And unfortunately, those calculators that you can easily do that connect to your bank statement, that's not a true emission statement. Because, hey, if you spent $50,000 at Home Depot, what you know, you can't just say, oh, based off of this, we think it's, this is your emissions related to it. That's not right. What did you buy? You know, things that the things you buy are going to have very different profiles, and we want to have an accurate picture. And that's where accountants can come in to help. So I'm really excited to be working in that space. And it feels full circle, and that this is what I was doing, you know, 10 years ago today at zero. And I never thought when I left that role that I would be coming back, but I have come full circle, but I'm bringing a lot of the skills that I have with me. And I'm really focused on how can I support people to, you know, my brethren, you could say, of the accounting industry to move into the unknown and use the skills they already have to make a positive impact on the world.
Ooh, I love that last statement. Use the skills that we have to make a positive impact on the world. That's this. A lot of the things that I talk about is using our accounting skills in a different context. And at the center, we use improve the world to improve the world. It's really, it's about driving that improvement all along. We've talked about these skills. Do you feel like any of your skills are your superpower, or something that's maybe special or unique to the that lets you be even more effective in what you do?
Yeah, I don't know if they're, my curiosity, I think, is the thing that, following my curiosity is what's really led me to the interesting things, and creativity, seeing the connections that people might not have seen, you know, going, and systems thinking. So what systems thinking is, it's very poorly named, to be honest, because it's not really about thinking, but it's about understanding that the world is inherently interconnected and complex. So how do we understand how it's connected to make better decisions or to understand the impact of it? So a good example of that is in New Zealand, they have a sales tax called GST, Goods and Services Tax. And they raised that sales tax from 12.5% to 15% in 2011. That makes sense. And it made a lot of sense for me. Sales tax is not as easy to avoid as income tax, right? So it's easier for them to raise that and know that, hey, this is actually going to lead to this much more revenue for New Zealand as opposed to income tax. But from a systems thinking perspective, who do you think is going to be impacted the most by that? it's going to be the lower income people who do not have as much income for their groceries every day. Every single bill of theirs is now raised by 2.5%. And that's negatively impacting them more than, say, an income tax rate. That's not something that you really think of when you're just looking about it at as a closed system, you could say. That's like, oh, I'm only looking here. I'm only solving for this, you know, because the world's interconnected. And so systems thinking, understanding how things are connected is a huge boon. And the reason why I'm so committed to supporting accountants, because taking a systems thinking lens, which is really looking at like, where are the points of influence? If I change this, what is the impact around, you know, like, cause what you want is to make the smallest, you want a high return on investment, smallest investment for the highest amount of impact. And when I look at that, the accounting industry and moving into a wider measure of value is, I see, like, the acupuncture point that's going to just enable business as a whole to completely shift. And so it's that systems thinking and seeing the connections between things, because, you know, and that's not to say I'm perfect at this, right? Like, I was like, oh, I'm not an accountant anymore. My accounting totally is how I view the world. Me being raised in South Florida's magnet schools, it completely is how I see the world. It impacts. It's why I have a strong sense of social justice, which has led me to caring about how do we create the conditions at work for people to thrive. So that systems thinking just helps you understand, like, what is it that has made you who you are? Like, what are the experiences and things that have shaped you? But then also when you're looking at how can I make the change that I want to make, really considering how what you do is going to impact others, even as much as like how you budget, you know, from an accounting perspective, how you decide to split investment. Like, that's huge. That could have such huge impact on the health of your people, just from a decision that you make in isolation that makes it easier for you to facilitate could actually really negatively or positively impact your business. So yeah, I would say systems thinking, creativity, I would say, and curiosity are my superpowers.
That's awesome. We have several common superpowers there. It's going to be funny when people listen to both of our interviews. Let's flip that. So if that's your superpowers, what's your critical vulnerability?
My critical vulnerability is definitely my caring. Yeah, I would say caring, right? Like, it can be really hard for me being a systems thinker and seeing how things work, like understanding like the behaviors within an organization that are creating the conditions that are hurting people, and being able to see that and kind of see these amazing like people I really love to enjoy in work, in a work experience that there's no way, given the culture that they're in, the way things are done, the systems and the processes, there's no way they're going to get out of it. And it can really hurt my ability to, my drive to want to even be in that system or to see change. And so that can be a real, yeah, I guess the double-edged sword of systems thinking is being able to see when things are in a situation that people can't influence. They can't influence the situation they're in, which is why I'm moving into it. But from a more practical, you know, like, what's a vulnerability and why I'm not a traditional accountant is my attention to detail. My ability to do the same thing over and over again has completely just washed away over the years, which is why I'm an entrepreneur now that loves experimenting and loves doing all of these things. But I've learned that I just need to get people who love that stuff to work with, because that's actually not a bad thing about me. That's just not one of my strengths. And it's my job to play to my strengths. And my strength of kind of like systems thinking means, oh, I'm aware of that, and I just need to get somebody on board who's better at that.
So let's say someone wanted to follow per se in your career footsteps, maybe not exactly, but to be able to do what you're doing now, what advice would you share with them?
Yeah, follow what sparks joy. And yeah, follow what sparks joy. And that may be very challenging for you, right? You've just invested all this time. You know, when I left accounting, I had studied for over 6 years in accounting, 4 years in America, and then I think about 2 years. And then I did all the training to become a CA. I thought I was giving up something that was important. I mean, it was a hard decision to make, even though it was tangential. I was jumping off the ladder and choosing something different. But the thing is, you don't start, you don't jump off the ladder, you know, like you step off the ladder, but you're not any further down. You're just not on the ladder. Like, that's not the only way. The ladder got you to a new platform, and you can figure out if you're going to take the jungle gym, whatever, the rope swing, whatever it is, you can come up. So I'd say follow what sparks joy. That's not to say that every minute of work is going to be great. And I would say that when you're early career, if you're in like a graduate role, I'm still so thankful for the 4 years I had, because I had a cohort of grads that I was working with that I'm like deeply friends with still. And I learned how to be a professional. You know, I learned how to show up at 8:30 and leave at 5, and to dress professionally, and to write emails in a professional way, and to follow up with people. And I learned a lot of skills that while I might not be in there, it was still valuable. So it's one of those things of really understanding like what sparks joy and gives you energy and what doesn't, and try and maximize the joy and minimize the drudgery. Because there's always going to be drudgery, but don't go for a job where it's 100% drudgery. Job craft. And that's the other thing. If you've never heard of job crafting, that's looking at the job that you're in and understanding you and what you want to do, and figuring out how you can work with your manager or your team to craft your job to fit more of what you're good at. So a good example of that's what I described of when I was at my accounting firm, and I was able to craft my job as an accountant to actually be to support the wider company to make this leap from one software to another for preparing as a client ledger and preparing reports. So that's an example of it. So it's not to say I'm not happy, quit my job, especially when the economy as it is. It's about really noting what do I enjoy doing, and can I figure out how to do more of it. And sometimes the worst jobs you have that you completely hate are the best things that you can do, because it gets you to that point where you go, well, something needs to change, and what do I want to do? So those moments. But yeah, follow the joy, follow the things that light you up, follow your curiosity, because it's going to lead you in the direction where work is going to feel less like work, and you're going to feel more energized and like you're making a difference. And know that you don't have to be a traditional accountant to make a difference. Your knowledge is useful in a variety of roles. It's just a foundation. It's a shared language that we have that's evolving. And I hope that a few of you are interested in helping to evolve to help bring on that next wave, because that's exciting. Accounting is, you know, nobody's like, whenever somebody says, oh, you're an accountant, you don't look like an accountant, I'm like, I'm offended. I'm like, what does an accountant look like?
Same here, yeah.
And you know, like, I don't walk around with a calculator, you know, but it gives me a really useful view on the world. It means I can be an entrepreneur. I can read a bank, you know, I can read a balance sheet. I have a lot of skills that I'm leveraging because of that experience. So accounting can be sexy.
I think that's an ending phrase. Accounting can be sexy. So thank you so much for sharing all of your story. And I love how you explained all of the different aspects that we really can do with accounting as a foundation if we follow our curiosity and figure out what gives us joy. So thank you so much for joining me on the podcast today.
Thanks for inviting me, Donnie.
And I hope we'll see all of you again on the next episode of The Accounting Art.
The Center for Accounting Transformation provides business professionals with a network for utilizing innovations that are ready for adoption, the training and resources necessary to apply those innovations, and an opportunity to engage the talent and community needed to further the pursuit of innovative accounting practices that drive responsible and mindful business performance. Find out more at our website, www.improvetheworld.net. And if you're interested in sharing your own transformation stories, please contact us there. Thank you for listening to the CPA Trendlines podcast, a production of cpatrendlines.com, now available on iTunes. We hope you'll rate and review us wherever you find your podcasts to help other accountants find our show more easily. For more information, you can go to cpatrendlines.com.